On Earth, life began as a pattern. At first, competing against its environment for survival. Then, after generations of successful replication, schisms manifest, and the pattern turns upon itself, competing for limited resources, and from this struggle, man was born, armed with attributes that make him a better fit for survival, nerves that alert him to danger, blood that provides oxygen, and a remarkable mind capable of memory. All useful components, except when they are used against themselves. Nerves carry extreme pain. Blood can be shed as easily as it flows. And the mind? Well, some memories are best left forgotten. But somehow, man lives with itself in a delicate balance of self-preservation and empathy for other species. And now that he goes out beyond his own star, knowing full well what atrocities he is capable of, he must learn to live in harmony with other civilizations. And then perhaps, he could learn something of itself. Now, imagine a competing pattern. One that is only concerned with replicating itself. It is not capable of remorse. It is irrelevant. Sovereignty is irrelevant. All resources are directed towards the ultimate goal: assimilation of all species.
Magnify. Dwarf, dispatch a subspace message to Admiral Hanson. We have engaged the Borg.
Now these two patterns come face to face, one self-aware of its tendencies, and the other with the advantage, as it does not share that capability. Replication is its purpose, no matter the cost. With all the technology and knowledge incorporated into one collective conscience, how could man ever compete? Compromises must be made. In this expanding galaxy that spans light years and has infinite amount of space to retreat into, surely he could find a way to survive.
Listen carefully. In the hearts of men, there is only a finite limit to the compromises they are willing to make. One man has come to know these limits. Now his crew is tasked with bringing him home, back from wherever and whenever the machines have taken him, back to reality, back amongst the living. Listen carefully. Somewhere in between the stars and below time, amongst the collective conscience of conquered civilizations, here in subspace, the fragments of this man's voice could be heard as it screams out in terror. Aware of his immediate surroundings, it is cold and dark. He lies down as the machines go to work and assimilate his mind. His memory is no longer memory. It is data. They have what they need. Now they turn their attention to perverting his body. They insert ungodly instruments into every crevice, and where none exists, new ones are created to accommodate the tubes. They are alive as they snake their way deeper inside through his skull and into the brain. In the reality above, his senses are no longer his senses. They are simply another input for the machines to process. Below, where his conscience resides, he is aware and in pain. The pain is unbearable. He can feel every turn as the machines explore his insides. He feels every tear and intrusion. Above, a certain liquid begins to fill his mouth. In pain, he struggles to recall this sensation. The odor should be familiar, and the taste, undeniable. It goes unrecognized as he lies here, dying. Somehow, in a binary reality of machine and not machine, he is able to exist as a contradiction. He is both in the same manner and same time, machine and not machine, human and not human. As the machines canal themselves deeper into his body, they come across an unexpected object. An artificial heart, programmed to keep cadence with the human. It is made of a synthetic alloy. The design is crude, but effective. How strange. This species willingly integrate themselves with superior mechanisms, but hesitate to embrace their new, near-perfect technology. Worse, they resist. How strange. The heart will be assimilated and made perfect. The species will be assimilated and brought into the collective so that they may exist forever without flaws, as intended. Human and not human. He is almost gone now. Destined to exist underneath reality, while the machines use his body for their own sinister purpose. He watches while they use his knowledge to better destroy their enemies, his friends and allies. He can do nothing. He can only watch. The assimilation takes place beyond his control. But the machines have underestimated the resolve of the humans. They did not anticipate their willingness to risk themselves for the sake of one body, for one man. Robbed of his volition, he can only witness the events as they take place. He uses this time to contemplate his life and how it came to this. How he allowed himself to be captured and used. By his own account, he should be regarded as a failure. His crew manages to bring his body back from the brink. His mind is still lost, the damage done. His conscience is trapped below. His screams for help go unnoticed, except for those who know to listen. Listen. Listen carefully. Do you hear? Listen. It's there. Listen. It's there. Surrounded by his family now, he has never felt more alone. It is quiet, and the voices are deafening. Back home on Earth, he is out in space. Confused, he easily loses track of time and slips in and out of place. He is both here and there, and somehow, he is nowhere. For a few times a day, he is successfully able to concentrate, and immediately his train of thought drift towards his failure. He was commissioned to the most sacred of position, tasked with the welfare of his crew and the safety of all living creatures. He failed in both regards and survived. Now he has a lifetime to contemplate the matter, contemplate his survival, while others paid the ultimate cost. He can hear the voices as he sleeps. Help. Along comes his elder brother. Please. A man that is not his intellectual or physical equal, but somehow manages to bring the captain down to his level so that they may communicate without any pretense. His brother speaks to him about humiliation versus humility, about victory and jealousy, expectation versus reality, and he forces his little brother, the dear old captain, to confront the truth, and it stings. Now they fight in the field like children. As they crash through the vineyard, the captain bites the inside of his mouth, and they come to rest. With nowhere left to hide, his brother disappears, and they come face to face. The mud stings his eyes, while his senses return from wherever and whenever they were to where he is. The air is dry, and his eyes burn. In the distance, a child plays, and through the gash in his cheek, his artificial heart pumps a certain liquid, and then a sudden recognition. The odor was copper, and the taste is metal.
You don't know, Robert. You don't know. They took everything I was. They used me to kill and to destroy, and I couldn't stop them. I shouldn't have been able to stop them. I tried. I tried so hard. But I wasn't strong enough. I wasn't good enough. I shouldn't have been able to stop them. I shouldn't.
And by his failure, he should be certain of one thing. He is human.